Yes, I'm online. The presenter, yeah, good. Okay, welcome everybody. We are going to tell you a bit about our space, Hackerspace TD Venlo, and how we run a hackerspace for young hackers. Today we have Jelle.
Yes, I'm at the Hackerspace since 2013-14. Know the guys already 10 years, but I went to Ohm 2013 and I saw everything about hackerspaces. I thought, okay, let's do this. So I joined the club. I've been at the Boy Scouts for over 12 years, 3 years as team leader. And professionally, I'm an electrical engineer who went to system testing, software testing. So I look at stuff, poke stuff, ask the questions, and then tell politely people in charge that it's not working.
Yes, politely. Yeah. My name is Mark. I joined TD Venlo when I was 9 years old, so I have experience as a youth member and as a senior member. In my spare time, I'm a swimming teacher, so basically I know a bit about teaching kids how to do stuff. And in my professional doings, I'm also an electrical engineer. TD Venlo is the hackerspace for the region Noord- and Midden-Limburg. And we are a little bit other than most spaces what you are represented here. We are an association rather than a foundation. So we put the people in the center and not so much the organization. And we have these guided memberships, guided activities for our young members. Members in the age of 9 to 16, 17 years old. Why do we have guided kit memberships? And how do we do this? That's basically what we're going to talk about today. We teach them many things about electronics, computers, and so on. But why do we do that? Well, it's basically a part of our club history. Many years ago, the club started, and already back then, the youth group was one of the main tracks within the club. We want to get them while they're young, because when they are young, they come to you, they get enthusiastic, and they stay in the scene when they grow older. And furthermore, we have interaction between the younger and the older members, and that works pretty well. Well, about our history, around the 1960s, in the beautiful building in the upper picture, there was a community house founded by the Roman Catholic Church, the area of city center of Venlo. The building is called the Alt Wijshuis. That's a local Venlo dialect for the old orphanage. The building was used as an orphanage and many other purposes. And in this building, a church wanted to offer leisure activities of all kinds of natures. There was a club of stained glass makers, a club of reptile keepers, there was a youth disco, a chess club, and many, many more other clubs. And to run all this, there was a technical department needed. Hey, TD, technical department. This technical department, there were a few people, and they thought, well, if one of us quits, we need successors. So how do we do that? Well, we have clubs in the building with youth. Why not start our own club? A technical club. So that's what they did. And basically, they started a club where they where the kids could learn something about audio, about lighting. They were taught how to solder. They were taught the basics of electronics, and so on, and so on. In late 1990s, early 2000s, the internet came up. Everything became more and more individual. And our club, that worked out as the memberships went down. Less members, less active members, less kids. So we were thinking, what shall we do? What do we need to do? And then Jelle came in. I was at Ohm 2013. I saw these awesome hackerspaces things. Why not turn the club into a hackerspace? Put more emphasis on the club for seniors, start a new youth group, and bring in some new tools into the group. Arduino, Python, YouTube movies, Microbits, and so on and so on. And that's basically how we evolved from the old youth club. Well, we had also a senior club, but the technical department, we evolved into a hackerspace. And back now in 2016, we rebooted with the youth group that we have now. And that is quite a success. We're almost full for the youth group.
We're full. How many people? 14.
14 kids. In the age of 9 to about 16.
And at 16 they probably can do everything themselves.
Yeah, then they naturally flow into the senior group.
And how many adults?
Adults also about 12, 13, yeah. Mm-hmm. So now we're going to tell you a bit how we run this club for the kids, and that's Jelle's part.
Two
women.
Yeah. So
one of them is actually they are both here.
And one of them is giving a talk.
Yeah.
Still only boys.
Only boys at the moment.
It's already hard enough with the moving and that kind of stuff to diversify even more. We needed, of course, need a bit of structure, because if you're 9, well, the world is your playground, but it's really large. And so we have Friday evenings from 7:30 till 9. We offer, what they want to do. Well, every kid starts with a digital detox with soldering the Roman numerals, which is normal soldering. On 2.5 millimeter VD wire, so they also learn to strip it, how to straighten it, and the Roman numerals start with easy and become more difficult, and then we do some extra figures. And also we have the other room where the computers are, and
basically when they're a bit longer in the club, they switch back and forth. We notice that they say, well, I have been soldering for 2-3 evenings, I have done enough of that. I want to go to the computer room, do a bit of hacking, programming, play a game, whatever. And after 2-3 weeks, they say, well, I have had enough of the computer. Let me make something again.
Yeah, so that's running back and forth. And the idea is we have had a fixed track. But my main question is now, when they come in, what do you want to do this evening? And then let's see if we can facilitate that. And if they don't know, well, here, we have something. Well, we have, of course, the soldering. So their kid is making a cube. So that's after the numerals, then we go 3D. And you saw the little wooden board with a dual blinker. That's the next step. So you have a wooden board with nails, and then you solder between that. And on the right hand, you see our Christmas challenge. So we went to AliExpress for $350. You have an animated tree, which the lights are also going everywhere. China will take everything over because it's so cheap. The problem was last year we also had to move. The computers were torn down, and we need more kids to solder.
Yeah, while we were packaging all our stuff, the club for the youth was still running.
Yeah. We also had teardowns. Too bad for the old sons that couldn't move, but yeah, stuff needs to go. And they learn how stuff is put together. We ordered the Christmas trees, and about 1.5 months before the end of the year, we're like, okay, this is a Christmas tree, and if you want to do that, you must be able to do the dual blinker on the wooden board. I have never seen kids so fast take a piece of wood and start putting nails in it.
True.
But this was a really accelerated track and big success until the end of the year to keep them occupied. And we just moved. We now had two evenings, and we only have hardware at this moment, so we also have some instruction. We want to reduce the instruction, like it should be 10% instruction, and the rest should be projects or just playing. Otherwise, we'll come to that later. Yeah. Computing, well, we can do everything again. That's really the great stuff. The kids, they're young. We have challenges like they don't know math and they don't know English. So we start now with the microbit because that is a product between BBC and NXP, and they also translated everything from English to Dutch. And yeah, it's a handy format for children. Then Python is something like real programming. And on the website codingkids.nl, they have a course programming Python for children, and that occupies them for 3 to 4 weeks, and they learn the basics. The problem is nothing sticks too much, but at least until they get the end, then everything is all right. So the figure you see there, that is just the point. Ah, that's that one. That. The Python with coding kits, they use logo with the turtle. It is import turtle, and then they can make all kinds of figures with ifs and for loops and that kind of stuff. And after that we go to Arduino, start with the blinking LED. I was so fed up with typing documents once I made my 3x3x3 LED cube. Well, that's also quite a challenge. And then you can also do some serial programming. So you can do with Python, you can do blinking LED, and with Arduino you can do Hello World. And one other thing we'll see when they're programming, it's such a mental activity. After 20 minutes, they start to overheat. So yeah, they need to do something different between. So
yeah,
okay,
it's typically 20 minutes. We see that also in the swimming.
Yeah, and then. one of the games we have we also use is 2048. And first they need to play it for an evening, and they think, ah, fun playing games. And then in the end of the evening, okay, now it's the overhearing. We start with 2, 4, 8, and what's next? And then the week after that, they go up to 8192, so that's good. And for Android, you have the game Circuit Scrambler with AND and OR ports. That also works quite good. They don't know what AND and OR ports are. The challenge is get that black thing in the top glowing, and then push buttons, and then it accelerates. So
The name of the game.
Circuit Breaker, I thought. I can look it up later. And, well, if you have them going back and forth between the different rooms, then you also can combine electronics and programming, and we go to a more mechatronic track. So we have the robot arm we upgraded ourselves. And also with Arduino you can do all nice combinations like the LED cube or LED strips and that kind of stuff. ESP is great because it's really a level higher because, it's 3x3 volts. You need serial communication, Wi-Fi, networking. Yeah. Raspberry Pi is a nice platform, so they can start using Linux. But yeah, we already run Linux everywhere. That's really fun. We have Linux, Ubuntu everywhere. The kids come in, they can use it. It doesn't matter from, this isn't Windows, I don't know. No, my phone does something else, my tablet does something else, my computer does something else, that computer also does something else. If they know how to open the file manager, they're good to go. It's amazing.
Yeah.
And once in a while, we go outside, like the Maker Faire, which... Maker Faire Eindhoven is really good for educational material for kids. It was a bit ruined for us because we would like to have more serious robots and more adult hacks. But unfortunately for us, but fortunately for the kids, they were really inspired and they were like, okay, I want to make that and I want to make that. And also where we went to was the DASA, the Deutsche
Arbeitssicherheitsamt. Deutsches Arbeitssicherheitsamt.
Ausstellung. this is a museum with everything from work technology from the past, today, and the future.
It's for the Dutch of us, it's a museum from the German Arbodienst.
And here you see a printing press from the late 19th century. They also have the really big one where the people in the museum need to have ear protection and the guests don't because, will be leaving soon.
It's to educate the guests why you need ear protection.
Yes. what of the other things we do for the adults, we go to Volstem in Brussels the first weekend of February. If you want to know something about open source software, then you learn a lot. You also learn why you need open source software. Also, Benno's talk really was like, okay, in the end, Stallman was right, but then we're probably too late. So, but for government, we need more open source stuff. And last year we saw that we have a model plane club also since the 60s just outside Venlo, and I think we're going to give them a call that we want to see one evening what they're doing. And normally, at the end of the year,
End of the season mostly. Just last evening before summer holidays.
We do a game evening with all kinds of open source games. I have a blog post on tedevenlo.nl which describes the games. And also, we just started and we're like, okay, we're still gathering speed. And where do we want to go in the future? And we're like, where do the kids want to go in the future? So we had a brainstorm session. And that ranges from, okay, I want to build my own operating system in Python. Okay, let's see how I'm going to do that. till I don't know, and we'll see how we can motivate people there, because the problem with
if they don't know, we just put out some projects, pick one.
We just started in the new space, so we also do a bit of instruction with TED Talks from Arduino from Mr. Bunzi. And they now have a journal, so they can log what they're doing and track their projects. I was at a talk yesterday for Makerspace curriculum. He said also journal is really important, so to keep people motivated and focused and to keep their ideas. But we'll see how it goes. We did two sessions with around 7 kids each. And you see if they're in... primary school, they're like, I just want to do something with LEDs and I don't want school. And if they're on secondary school, they're like, I don't want nothing like school, but I also want to build cool stuff. So, we'll see how that goes. So, this is the summary. Well, we say it offers an extra dimension. Also, the interaction between young and adults. We had a small discussion about, okay, should we separate them? Because if some teenagers go off on Friday evening and you're looking at your code like, oh, this is, I can concentrate. But on the other hand, it's really fun to explain the concepts to kids. Yeah. And it's really inspiring for the kids if one of our lead hackers takes their robot arm and things go, and they're like, what the hell is this? Get them while they're young, so you get lots of members.
You get them in, and some of them will stay.
Yeah.
Not all, but some will.
Yeah, but with every club. That's
that's everywhere.
And the present offers the best tools. It's amazing. If you were in the early zeros, it was a desert if you want to do electronics as an adult. And now, AliExpress and all the platforms... It's all there, and you just ask them, what do you want to do? And that's about it. Yeah. Questions?
In the
tower mic.
Hi, can you tell me something about the technical setup of the space, of your hackerspace? What equipment do you need and what is already there and what have the people bring them on every meeting and... Can you tell us something about your equipment?
We have two rooms with around 8 desktops for the computing track, And for the rest, if you want to get started on the hardware, we have three benches which fit around 3 to 4 kids if you're pushed hard enough. With for everyone a soldering iron. And if if they start out, you just need lots of VD wire, soldering equipment, and you're good to go. And then you need regular wire, some LEDs, ELCOs, resistors, transistors. Then for the Arduino, you buy the fake Duinos. And the micro bits are a bit expensive, they're around 20 euros. But
what about safety? Working?
Working safety. That was one of the outcomes of the brainstorm sessions. What don't you want to do? Well, safety and security were the things that the kids themselves want. So we give instruction. Also, the Arduino, it's all SELV, say voltage power. And like I heard someone from HEC42 say, if they're still 16, no power tools and that kind of stuff. So, but and hammering,
and we
pliers.
Also have emergency buttons.
The emergency
buttons indeed to switch off the power immediately. And we try to have about at least one supervisor per four, but preferably one supervisor per 2 or 3 kids.
And always look over the shoulder,
yeah,
without them knowing it.
And the supervisors are other members.
That's the senior members.
Yeah, and that really differs from evening to evening. Who helps out what? Huh? There's a commission that's responsible for the training program. But
it grows really naturally.
Yeah.
People can also say, I don't like to do that, or
that's no problem.
That nothing is compulsory, but we see that they want to help themselves.
It inspires when seeing someone do it inspires most of the people to do it also.
The tools you use for training people, I know that for instance Codecademy offers like badges you have in scouting and certificates, like in Certified Secure. Is that something you will
use? We're looking into that. Yeah, we saw that also at the Maker Fair. Mozilla offers also such kind of badge.
Yeah,
and,
it's really inspiring.
Achievements kind of thing, but we're still redecorating and filling up the space, and then we're going to upgrade our tracks.
Yeah, and like the hacking part of the hacker space.
Yep.
It's mostly DIY?
The hacking part, because we have no security researchers in our hackerspace.
Okay.
None.
Yeah.
That's really strange for a hackerspace. But
like they're doing the ethicals and law and legislation, the training of
That's something that comes up from the kids themselves. I want to learn to hack how to... Okay, so there is the course Hack in the Class that I want to bring in. So at least that
or
will...
Or bring Jure in and have him do his talk.
Where do you live?
Hellevoetsluis, but I have family in Deurne, so that's...
Okay. Then
halfway there.
Okay, then we'll keep you posted. There's a question there.
What do you do on promotion, especially for the kids, to get more kids?
If you get one young kid, he tells it in class, and the next year he tells it again in class.
Yeah, so our reboot was basically we had the Open Hackerspace Day. 2 or 3 kids came by. Well, this is great. We want to do this. So we said, okay, we gathered the 3 of you together to come at the same time. They came, they started, they had fun, became a member, and then it spread around. They asked their friends to come, classmates to come, and within a year we had like 11 kids.
And now we're also situated in the library, so we can also use the promotional channels of the library and, of course, social media and that kind of stuff.
Do you make an extra effort to get the girls in there as well?
Not at this moment, but I think we'll need to discuss that
I think we can do that in combination with the library.
Yeah.
The library also wants to do that kind of stuff, and I think we can be great partners in that.
We had a discussion with the library about the activity we would do together, and the girls and boys stuff came up, and library says, yeah, normally when we do the activities with the books, only the girls come. And with the tech, only the boys come. So, yeah, okay, we'll see how it goes in end of March.
Do the children pay any fee, or do you get a subsidy, or any other funds?
We're totally independent,
yeah.
And they pay $7.50 per month,
okay.
Which is for youth activity quite cheap.
And is there a reason for that you are not sponsored or
we haven't looked that hard yet.
Excuse me?
We haven't looked that hard yet into sponsoring.
We did not really need the money from sponsoring yet to run our space.
Yeah, it's very cheap to do.
In the Alt Weishuis, the old building,
yeah.
we were kind of a supportive department. We didn't need to pay anything about rent or that.
Yeah.
And now in the library, we also do not need to pay rent for the rooms.
We just need to do 4 activities in cooperation with the library.
Okay, nice. Thank you.
Okay, last question.
One more.
A question about supervising kids. Are there any requirements from the authorities for you to supervise the kids?
That's no, a okay. good one.
I'm a bit
out of date, but I was Boy Scout leader for about 3 years,
mm-hmm.
and Scouting Netherlands has their training programs to do that.
But is that also covering your activities?
But there's nothing mandatory, for as far as I know.
Okay.
No.
And
as I know, but the swimming is a bit different because it's sports and it's in the pool and there is physical contact with the kids. Mm-hmm. So there you need to hand in a VOG to your association or whatever where you are doing the activity.
But otherwise for these activities?
Nothing.
For this activities,
also, the library
no.
doesn't ask for anything.
Okay. Thank you.
And yeah, I also train martial arts, and they are more sharp on that kind of stuff.
Yeah, but that's what I said, is when there is a physical contact, then you need to do the stuff. But if it is in this kind of thing, yeah, you need to know a bit what you're doing.
Yeah.
And that's basically, and if you can somehow assure that you know what you're doing, then it's fine.
Is there a reason that you are an association and not a foundation? Is there a particular reason?
Yeah, we looked into it, and we're like, okay, we want to focus on the people, not on the capital, and that's why we're an association. And the democracy part, a lot of spaces find it a liability, and I think if you organize it correctly, you can make it a strength.
Yes.
Okay. I think we're there.
Amazing presentation.
Thank you.
Thank you.